Yo, ladies and gentlemen, I am MC Zinman, and welcome back to Space Engineers Weekly Workshop Roundup number 18. As always, I'm bringing you three of the hot ships and three of the hot mods from the Space Engineers Steam Workshop page. But this time, not for the last week, once again, real life and everything. Shouts out to everybody who watched the last episode. It's got over 1,000 views so far. 16 likes, 7 dislikes too. Also thank you to the guys who disliked, because you're keeping it real, letting me know that I can still improve. But wow, that was incredible. We went from 69 subscribers to 83. We're just 17 subscribers away from 100. It's absolutely incredible. And, well, I believe we can do it this video. Come on, if you really like this stuff, then go and hit that subscribe button. It'd be awesome to get to 100 subscribers on this channel. Thank you guys for all your support. Now, first of all, we got Advanced Turret Control to start things off today, by DraygoKorvan. This is not an advanced turret control. This is, in fact, just a vanilla missile turret. And that's because this mod doesn't actually have a block. What it does is it's a way to automatically set your target. So you take control of the turret, you set your target using the control key, which for me is unfortunately also fire. And, the turret will keep track of it. And if it's an enemy ship, it'll also keep firing on it. So super interesting. Here I'm trying to set the ownership to me. It does that. It just automatically goes off on this ship over here, this HSI ship that I have, that came with my world, that I have to defend my base. And then it changes targets and starts firing on the Osiris parked over there. It's crazy, but that's not the script's fault. That's my fault. I'm horrible with all of this ownership stuff. I don't really know how to do it. I couldn't get the script to actually work properly because I'm just so bad with ownership. Like, I'm just terrible with ownership. But pretty much you get the idea. I try to fly over here to the turret and see if it's tracking me. It's actually not, so I of course have to hop out and do a little bit more playing around with the ownership and setting the target and everything. I eventually paste another one in, and this time it worked pretty much perfectly. I nicked a thruster there just trying to set the target, and as you can see, well, it's tracking me. If I was an actual enemy ship, it would keep firing on me. So what that does, why that's a good thing, it sort of opens up different roles for other players. Like, if you're trying to run a ship with multiple players, then you can have more players focusing on keeping the ship intact, and you can just set all of the, all of the defense systems to automatically target like a certain ship. So super, super innovative idea. Yep, it's tracking me. I did play around for a while with this, trying to get it to fire on me, but once again, for some reason, it just didn't work. I tried changing ownership again, and and just a whole bunch of stuff behind the scenes that you guys don't see. I couldn't get it to work, but you probably can. Anyway, so moving on to MCM Door Ramp by moderncolin. Yep, it's a hangar door, except it's far bigger than most hangars. Like, even the small door is pretty freaking huge for a hangar door. This is not really the small version, this is the large version. And then over there in the distance, you saw there's a, holy crap, that thing is freaking huge version. This is it here. It's massive. It's the largest block we've ever seen here on the show. You could fit a huge ship through this thing. Absolutely massive. Obviously, now there's one gripe that I have with it. We're going to get to that pretty soon. But yeah, just look at the floor below it, right? Look at the floor below it. That's a complete floors. Like, the interior is about two blocks high, and then you got two more blocks, you know, one for the floor, one for the roof. It's like, it's bigger than that. It's way bigger than my engineers you saw there. So I built myself a little bit of a hangar, a land vehicle garage outside in the desert here. Pretty nice, pretty open. And yeah, you can see sort of the surroundings and all of that. Now that's the Tempest truck that we're going to be reviewing later on. I thought that would be a good thing to try to use to see exactly how easy it is to get a land vehicle in here, but well, it's not. You can see that I just smacked the front end off the door ramp. That's one thing that I wish that the door ramp had, the MCM door ramp. I really wish it had some sort of setting where you could adjust how much it opens. It caused some pretty significant damage to the Tempest. But fortunately, the Tempest has this sort of repair grid thing. I was able to get back working pretty soon. And then, of course, I get it stuck. That's another reason I think that it needs a way to adjust how much it opens. So eventually I turned the Tempest around and backed it in, got up a lot of speed, smacked the front end off the ground there, but eventually I did get it in. Thing is, with the store, your vehicles have to have stupid ground clearance if you're gonna use land vehicles. Obviously, you know, with the Starship, you're not gonna have to worry about that, but let us move on now to the planet Neirri by Dr. Octoganapus. Yeah, that's a heck of a last name there. But Neirri is an Earth-like planet with unique vegetation and large grasslands. As you can see here, absolutely wow. Just such a beautiful planet. Just so, so gorgeous. Such amazing fun to explore too. That's something that we're going to get into a little bit later. Is so fun to explore on ground level. There's just so much to see, you know, and so much to do. There's so many areas of just extremely challenging terrain, and I'm big into off-roading in quite a few games. GTA 5, you can't stop me, for instance. MX versus ATV Reflex, I got that. Huge fan of off-roading in that game, super fun. But look at this. You got the grasslands, you got the ice lakes, you got the mountains, you've got just the views, stunning views all around. And of course, the unique vegetation here. As we are taking sort of a panning look at that ice lake there. Gorgeous, gorgeous stuff. And I just want to point out that the textures on these plants are absolutely ridiculous for space engineers. They're insane. You can get so close to one of these plants before the textures start becoming blurry that it is absolutely crazy. Yeah, you can see just get up right on them and they start becoming blurry. This is actually one of my favorite plants here. Just the myriad sort of colors of blue and green and all of that stuff. So, so beautiful. Just wow. Absolutely wow. That's all I gotta say. And the thing is, exploring, unless you're exploring on foot, you're not gonna be really seeing all that much of that. Yeah, so, of course, I decided to give the jackal buggy a good old test here to see if it was in fact as good as I thought it was going to be. This, by the way, the jackal buggy was made before planets were even a thing. It was made back around the time of that one planet asteroid map thing that was supposed to give us a good idea of what planets were going to be like. And even though it wasn't really built strictly for planets, even though it was built for that map, it copes so well with the terrain here that I'm absolutely stunned. The author of the Jackal Buggy, of course, MGE Leon's or GTE, one of the Space Engineers Steam Workshop's very best authors. So this guy knew what he was doing. The default settings worked magnificently. I was just able to paste it and get going right out of the box. Able to get up stupid speeds, perform huge jumps. Even with, I believe, block damage was on, it may have been off. But it just worked so well. And that crash there was obviously my fault. I mean, even the Jackal has its limits. But, yep, just a little bit of a roll there. And, of course, watch this. Alright, watch this. This is pretty much straight down. And I get a little bit stuck here coming up. But this is straight down almost. This is like a 75% grade or something ridiculous like that. Of course, up here in a few feet, well, right here, I encounter a little bit of a blockage, but I keep going. I'm able to get out of that. I'm able to just keep going down the side before deciding that there's no way I'm going to be able to get over that. And then I catch my rear wheel on something, roll it over. That this is a perfect example of how challenging and how fun exploring Neirri is. And of course, you got the grasslands if you feel like getting up a little bit of speed, which I certainly did. And well, the wheels freaked out. I caught quite a lot of air, and then I rolled it and proceeded to get stuck in a very weird position. It's basically a statue now, as we see. And I get out and I start to try and fix it, but the cyberhounds come and say hi, so I have to shoot them, and then they start floating when I kill them. Floating cyberhounds. Yeah, that's definitely a thing that's happening in my life right now. I was very confused when that happened, and then I decided to freak out and just celebrate my victory over cyberhounds kind. But yeah. So, Neirri, absolutely gorgeous plant. And then, of course, I place the lights on because why not? Why not? Right? Why not? I mean, everybody likes lights on, lights on, lights on, lights on, lights on. Sorry, every time I do that, it sort of freaks me out a little bit. You know, shorts my circuits, but look at this, all right? Look at this. I really love that green sort of distance fog that he's got going on, that Dr. Octoganapus has put in this plant. That green distance fog, for some reason, it just adds so much to the atmosphere of this planet. And that's adding on to a plant that's already incredibly gorgeous. Incredibly so. And just flying above it all, just sort of giving a little bit of a look. Of course, I see this absolutely gorgeous ice lake here, and I have to stop. I have to stop. So, set the Osiris down, open the cockpits up, and just hop out and have a little bit of a sit down on the beach. Just look at this. So peaceful. So gorgeous. Just sitting here looking at the tree line just vanishing off into the distance there. That is the definition of tranquil. I'm going to shut up now so you can see it. So you can feel it, experience it. Absolutely gorgeous. So now we turn our attention back to the Tempest truck. This is a little bit of insanity. Of course, the Tempest truck is by the one, the only AssHunter. Quick note, I didn't do this. You can press 2 in the first toolbar to improve stability at high speeds so that you don't flip over. And yeah, I do flip over a couple of times, I believe, but that's probably because I didn't press 2. If I had pressed 2, then that would have helped. Let me just say, I really love the styling of this truck. It looks like something, it reminds me of something, again, I know I say this every episode, but it reminds me of something from Mass Effect. It Reminds me of something that Cerberus might make, the terrorist company. I mean, of course, Cerberus is evil, but they make some pretty cool looking stuff. You have to admit, they made the original Normandy SR2, and that looked cool. So, yep. This, I approve of the styling, absolutely. So, seeing outside of the, land vehicle garage that I built, and yeah, just this truck is insanely fast. You're gonna see that pleasantly, but just this truck is ridiculously quick. Look at the acceleration, that's kilometers an hour. In case you can't really see it, but that's kilometers an hour. We're already up to 150, 160, 70, 80, 90, 200. It's ridiculous, it's so fast. The acceleration on this is, it's mental. It's really, really crazy. I was absolutely surprised the first time I tested the Tempest truck at just how fast it was. And of course, even without number two activated, it's still pretty stable, but it's not invulnerable to idiocy. Like, it's not idiot-proof, as I just proved there by taking a massive jump and then landing nose diving into the next hill. I'll tell you what else this reminds me of. It reminds me of one of those Baja semi trucks that they have in the Baja 1000, and probably a few other international motorsport events. But the reason I say that is because it's got those four spare wheels back there, and those have those four spare wheels also, and it's got another cockpit beside you too for a passenger. So yeah, I got the Tempest truck fixed after that little run-in with the ground there. And, well, there's this neat sort of little off-roading area sort of at the border of the desert, and I decided to go ahead and give the Tempest a little bit of a run through there. And, well, it would have gotten down this first hill had it not been for that tree. And yeah, I put it on its side and then on its roof. There's going to be no rescuing that one, so I pasted in another one. And, well, that hill back there is our next target, and it destroys it. It completely destroys it. It's insane. Like, that hill is a lot steeper than it looks. I'll tell you that much right now. That hill is a lot steeper than it looks. We go up it without a problem. We're doing 70, we're gaining speed pretty much. Yeah, we're gaining speed going up this hill. No problem. That's a very steep hill for a land vehicle. No problem. So, of course, I fired it at another steep hill that I just happened to see. And, well, it got defeated by this one. But I adjusted the wheel settings, kicked the friction and the power all the way up. And, well, this happens. It goes flying up the hill after it gets stopped, of course. It goes flying up the hill ridiculously fast. Ridiculously fast. We're doing 140 kilometers an hour was our peak speed there. And then hits a bump. There's a celebratory little midair flip there as if to say, that's right, you are my bitch hill. But then, of course, it screws up. Forgets that physics are a thing that exists, and then it rolls back down the side of the hill, but without a scratch. It lands without a scratch. This truck, by the way, the durability on it, even if it is made out of light armor, it's insanely durable. Aside from, of course, the battery that we smacked off the MCM loading ramp there, but as long as you don't hit the front and bottom there too hard, of course there are other batteries and reactors on the inside, so it's not like that's your sole source of power, but it's still very, very durable. And now we are moving ahead to the Trident vanilla fighter by the first timer Rose. It's a VFSW fighter. I'm not exactly sure what that means, but it's, like I'd say, completely vanilla. And I just want to point out, this thing looks ridiculous. Yeah, it looks pretty crazy. I will admit that for a vanilla ship, a vanilla fighter ship, I really like the look of this thing. It's sort of black. It's obviously it's very stealthy. It's got sort of a very sci-fi edge to it. I mean, you're not going to see anything that's remotely like this in the real world. But you see that? Hydrogen only, atmo thrusters only. That's the biggest thing about the ship that I don't quite like. But for a vanilla ship, completely vanilla thrusters and everything, this is pretty good. I mean, it's not very maneuverable, but we've learned over the course of this series that you can't really depend on vanilla ships to actually be that maneuverable, so I'll let it pass for that. You see, you've got one measly little hydro thruster there for your lateral thrust. Not that good at all. But seriously, I can't see one angle from which this ship looks bad. I mean, it's obviously not the best looking ship that we've had, but overall, I'd say it actually looks really good. Even the bottom. I mean, nobody pays attention to the bottom. Nobody, even I don't really do that much to make the bottom look good. I just use the bottom to sort of protect my stuff here. So taking off, as you can see, it's got a little bit of upwards thrust. You're going to need that, really, if you want to fly this thing with any sort of maneuverability. By the way, something that I didn't do in this filming run that I did before, it's got this little sort of cool thing where you can extend the rear wings and it makes it look super cool. Also, for some reason, you have to activate, I believe it's 3 on toolbar 2 to turn the missiles on, and 2 other Gatling guns. I don't know why it's like that. I just prefer it if, you know, all of your weapons are functioning out of the box, but anyway, whatever. It's also got this really cool sort of crosshair blueprint. I mean, it's a really sweet idea. I've never seen that implemented on anything before. Of course, being that it's a blueprint, if you turn too sharply, it starts drifting off to the side and becoming inaccurate. So I'd still rely on the vanilla crosshair. But that's a super cool idea. You have to admit, that's super cool. And if they could figure out a way to make it so that blueprint doesn't drift as you turn, that would be actually a far more effective crosshair, because it stands out more than the vanilla crosshair does. For instance, you can see here, you can see the shades of white. The shades of white in the crosshair and the shades of white on that sort of cloud there, very close. Really, the only thing that makes the vanilla crosshair stand out is the drop shadow, which can get lost in a few scenarios. So that sort of, that crosshair is very handy, but the lateral thrust. Yeah, it could definitely do with more than one measly little hydro thruster for the lateral thrust. It's not very effective at getting turned. It comes to bear pretty quickly, I will admit that. So flanking maneuvers wouldn't be a particular concern here, but it's just getting stopped, as we're about to find out with this cliff. I barely avoid the first sort of little bit here, and then I bounce off of it. And, well, we're about to find out another of the ship's strengths here. See, bang, bounce off it, no damage. I don't know why that is, because this is my ship review world. I'm pretty sure that I have block damage on, because that's an important aspect of reviewing a ship, is seeing how it reacts to damage. Of course, I still couldn't get stopped. That's the big thing. That's the big thing. If you can find a way to get this thing stopped, then the way it comes to bear, and you know that, of course, that crosshair, that's going to be super cool in a lot of scenarios. So just find a way to perhaps maybe stick a couple of other lateral thrusters on there. That's the one thing about using these vanilla thrusters and just all vanilla blocks, is that they don't have a lot of power. if you have to use mods to make your ship flyable and make it fun to play with, go for it. But yes, that is the Trident vanilla fighter. Now we're coming to the Ad Astra Industries AS Kems by Trozzo. Yep, this is a colony ship, and it's absolutely gorgeous. And it's a very strange looking ship, first of all. And strange to me is 99.9% of the time, it's actually a good thing. Just sort of a little shot from the top here. I really like how it looks like a real sort of space station, even though it's a ship. That really sells the colony ship sort of vibe, I think. I don't know why, but it just sort of really, really makes you... like, you look at this thing, you go, that's a colony ship. Or a space station, depending on who you are, but... like, if you see these thrusters here, you go, that's a ship, that's a colony ship, that's something that people are meant to live on for a long time. Beautiful ship, absolutely gorgeous. The off-white really, really makes it look cool, I have to say. So, flying under it, it's extremely long. Like, it's ridiculously, ridiculously long. Yeah, it's also very Spartan. You got a lot of beer sort of systems here. I like that. I like that sort of function above form approach because it's realistic. Like, you know, if you were going to build a ship this big, it would probably be stupidly expensive just for all these systems, right? So you're going to save a little bit of money by just making it function over form. And that actually, ironically, makes it look kind of cool to me because I really like ships and, you know, just really anything that's function above form. Race cars, anything like that. So, yep, it's nice. It's definitely very nice. And these are the dropships that, unfortunately, I wasn't able to include my footage of reviewing them because I just kept crashing them. I crashed them twice trying to get them plant side because I'm such a terrible pilot. Like, I'm just in this game, not very good, but... yep, so you can see the way they work over there. They got these merge blocks in these tunnels. And, you got these button panels on the inside of the actual AS Kems that you press, or, on the inside of these, actual ships to sort of undock and then pull away. So, on the inside, I'm gonna say this, this ship is very easy to navigate. This is how I like it. Straight forward, straight back. Of course, with sort of rooms branching off to the sides and up and down. Very simple navigation with this ship. And yeah, so we're sort of panning through the upper deck here. We've got that med station there. One thing that this ship, I don't think this ship has, is like a dedicated med bay, which is something that I really wish was kind of there, because in a colony ship, you know, you're probably going to be adventuring for months, if not years, even with warp drives. So that's one thing that I wish was in this ship. That and, you know, beds and stuff like that, but we'll get to that later. But other than that, it's pretty much got everything you need. It's got a hangar, it's got production storage, everything like that. And it's got these sort of signs off to the side that you just saw that help you navigate, as if it wasn't simple enough, which it kind of is. I will not lie. It's very simple to navigate. Also, every room in this ship is stunning. It looks absolutely gorgeous, especially once again for a vanilla ship. I won't press it in. Vanilla ship. This is all vanilla, zero mods. All of this ship, zero mods. It's crazy what you can do with space engineers these days. It's absolutely insane. So we got sort of the upper deck. You got a couple of passenger seats there. The cryo chamber. Well, one of the cryo chambers. There are a few more down there. So Going down the stairs to either side, we have these crew quarters here. And, well, the crew quarters are basically just sort of a housing for the oxygen tanks. Kind of weird. You don't actually have any chairs or anything, any beds, desks, whatever, that sort of thing. Which, once again, I wish you had some furniture for the crew, because, well, this is the colony ship. It doesn't really make that much sense to me, I will be honest. But you do, however, have quite a nice shower, obviously, without the shower head, because in vanilla ship, you know, you don't have that sort of thing, and, you know, the looms would be off to either side. Nice spacious sort of, well, group shower area there. Very comfortingly lit there. The lighting is nice in the ship, I will touch on that. And then, of course, you got some more cryo chambers. There you got jump drives. You've got jump drives too, to sort of speed up the journey. But once again, you're probably going to be spending months on end just cruising, so kind of nice to have these, I would say. So you could just hop in there, you know, in cage cryo, and just go sleep, wake up, and you're hopefully right at your destination world for your crew. And quite a lot of them too. I don't know how many that is, but just quite a lot of crew quarters. So moving back up the stairs, we come to, well, the sort of the main bridge area. It's one guy flying it, which is kind of weird. I would expect more. Of course, there are probably some cockpits that, you know, elsewhere that are part of the main body of the ship that I'm not seeing. But so now we are going to the Crossroads compound. And this ship is sort of split into compounds, not rooms. So you got, like, one compound, the jump drive compound, for instance, over there on the left. It's a compound that's split into sort of separate rooms. So just a little bit of a, just a little bit more navigational organization there, which is a kind of unique idea. This, by the way, these sort of sections where you get all this view of space, absolutely beautiful, I think. I really love epic huge views to space, and that really, really looks cool. So we're coming to the Crossroads compound now, and as you just saw back there, sort of branches off into all different sort of rooms. Sorry for hitting you guys in the face there. So this is the jump drives compound that the Crossroads leads to. Huge, huge area. This thing has so many jump drives. It's absolutely insane. I'm not sure exactly how many, therefore I'm not exactly sure how far you can get with one jump, but probably quite far. So now we're heading up into another sort of area in the jump drives compound. A couple of seats here, actually in the jump drives compound, just so you can get a little bit of a view out there. Status for all your jump drives, that's always sort of super, super handy there. Yep, a lot of jump drives, just a huge number of jump drives in this compound. I'm not exactly sure how many, but yeah. And then you've got, well, all of this data here. What is all that? I don't know what that is. So we're heading to the hangar bay now. The jump drives compound has a sort of a handy door that you can go that leads straight to the hangar bay, which is awesome. And we've got sort of all these reactors, and, well, I'm not sure these are reactors, but we got sort of these sort of reactors, refineries, whatever they are. So basically the hangar door is up top, so you just open up the hangar door and then your little ship drone, whatever, it flies in, and then you know, you just hook up straight to the storage system, and there you go. Now we're heading down into gyroscopics, and, well, really really, what more can you say? It's just sort of a little bit of a gyroscope room. This thing has a lot of gyroscopes. It doesn't turn very well because it's really freaking heavy, but I like how the gyroscopes are sort of up there on the walls. I think that's really kind of cool, so you can just walk up there and just sort of get right to them and fix them if you need to. It's a pretty nice little area here, but we're heading back through this sort of airlock area and back into the top this time of the hangar bay, I believe. And take a look at all this. Look at all this storage here. This thing has a ton of just places to store all your stuff. That gravity generator there, you got these conveyors, these oxygen tanks, and of course you got your med bay there. So, if your pilot needs to heal there, or if they've died and they need to respawn, they can just sort of hop right. They can just sort of respawn at that med station there. Kind of a cool idea. Because, like, if you've got a couple of fighters there and one gets destroyed and you still got a spare, you can just have your pilot respawn there, no problem. Just run back up, run to the next ship, deploy again. Pretty easy. One thing, though, I'm not sure what I think of those connectors there. They seem to be located very strangely. So back up into the main sort of crossroads, well, let's say in sort of crossroads area there, and through this door we have the actual production area. So off to the sides you got all the data that you need, and then, well, there's not really that much to say about pretty much. Now this is the first of three areas that sort of lead to docking bays. All the docking bays are lined straight up in a row, intercut with these sort of long hallways here. This is docking bay C. We're not going to get to docking bays B and A because they're literally just the same thing. You got those controls off to the side there to sort of dock and undock the actual the landing craft there. So you can read that. You can pause that and read it if you want to. But yeah, pretty much there's not really that much to say about it. It's just sort of a little docking bay. With, you know, the ability to dock and undock using merge blocks. Not really, again, that much to say about. This is the main storage dome. And, at first, when I looked at it on the Steam Workshop page, I thought that this ship actually sort of reminded me more so of a Quarian live ship from Mass Effect, because you look at a live ship, and look at pretty much any picture of the migrant fleet, you'll see one of the lift ships that are the big ones with the sort of greenery domes. And that's what this reminded me of. But yeah, so this is the storage compound. It's all very well organized and easy to get around. So you can pretty much access literally any of the ports there at any given time. You got this cockpit here that's meant for managing your storage. And then over here, you have the sort of AI area, the timer block, sort of a programmable block compound. The timer block's all over there on one side, and the programmable blocks are actually up on another floor entirely. And just sort of this little area here. Yeah, the programmable blocks there. And let me just say, by the way, I know I keep going on about views in this ship, but the view out the side onto the ship is absolutely gorgeous. I really love it. It's just so, I don't know how to describe it, but for some reason, I just really love it. It feels like almost a camera shot from Halo, pretty much. And a little tiny dedicated med bay there. But once again, I don't see the reason why you wouldn't have a med bay that's like in the main body of the ship. So moving on into the sort of main AI control bridge here. This is the last area, I believe, that we have to review in the ship. It's pretty nice. Nice and spacious. Couple of passenger seats there off to the side for your alien love interest. and a nice view out onto all of the oxygen farms and solar panels and all of the conveyor lines and everything. It's just, so this ship is so, it's got a Spartan charm to it, I think. It really, the basicness of it all, the fact that pretty much every system is laid bare for the eye to see from the outside, really just adds a certain character that we don't often see on this show, I believe. It looks pretty nice. It looks really nice, and a little bit of a view of that engine nacelle back there. And then, of course, coming back, you've got kind of a little sort of hallway here where you can get sort of a view of the top directional thrusters out of these windows here. Just, I don't know why it's there. Just sort of a little nice touch so you can see the thrusters. And, well, this is the sort of main AI bridge here. You got those four secondary bridges and then the captain's seat up on top and the pilot's seat right here. And just some sort of data there about how everything's doing. Yep. So, why don't we fly this thing? Now, as you can see, acceleration, I was actually kind of surprised at the acceleration, because we've had ships that have not accelerated this well before and been like a fraction of the weight. It's got some pretty potent acceleration with those mainsail thrusters. They're a pretty powerful ship. And of course, the turning is really, really nice. It can come to bear quicker than a lot of warships that we've actually seen, which is kind of crazy. I guess it would actually have to come to bear pretty quickly though, because once again, pretty much every crucial ship system has some part of it that's on the outside, so you want something, you know, some sort of maneuverability in order to protect those systems, just in case your jump drives weren't quite spooled up yet. And just sort of a little bit of a look around the outside of the ship. It's really long, as you can see. It's pretty freaking huge. It's pretty fun to fly. It really is. And of course, I'm not surprised about that at all, because it is an Ad Astra ship. And, Ad Astras are always fantastic ships. Like, if you can, if you have the spare time to go and take a look at Trozzo's Steam Workshop, I would highly recommend doing so, because all of his Ad Astras are pretty freaking fantastic. They really are. So, that will do it for this episode of the Space Engineers Weekly Workshop Roundup number 18. It was a super fun episode to film. Hopefully I can get this series back onto a weekly schedule. That's what I've been trying to do for months now, but unfortunately it just hasn't panned out quite yet. So please, please bear with me. If you like this video, then go ahead and bitch slap that like button. If you really, really like it and you want to see more, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. Hey, I've been MC Zinman. You've been awesome. I'll see you guys in the next video. Here's to 100 subscribers. MCZ out.